Hello and welcome to another edition of People Make a Difference, a presentation of California State University Dominguez Hills. I'm your host, Danny Brassell, and this is the show where we celebrate the positive contributions of individuals throughout our community. And it is my joy and pleasure to have with me a friend who is also a high school English teacher and an internationally recognized educator, author, extraordinaire. Thank you for joining me today. This is Kelly Gallagher with me.
It's very nice to be here. Usually I see you coming and going in an airport or at some literacy conference, so it's nice to visit you in your own digs.
It's great. I do have to share with the audience that the first time that we met, Kelly and I were on a flight together, flying from Denver, Colorado to Garden City, Kansas, and both of us had a window and an aisle seat, and we actually got to watch the pilots take off from the cockpit. It was pretty amazing.
Post 9/11, that was an interesting experience.
It really was. So, Kelly, tell us about you're ditching school today. You teach at Magnolia High School in Anaheim. Tell us about that.
I am a high school teacher in Anaheim. I work at Magnolia High. This year, I stand in front of two very distinct species, a 9th grade students and 12th grade students. So, midday, that requires a fairly heavy cognitive shift in thinking. But I've just now began teaching my 26th year.
26 years. Mm-hmm. Congratulations.
Thank you.
What changes have you seen during those 26 years?
Well, of course, there's been a big change in education, a lot more accountability. And I think in some ways that's very good. And I think in some ways that's brought some changes that are not in the best interest of our kids. So I would say more than anything in the last 10, 15 years, you know, once No Child Left Behind came into play, that a lot of changes have come into schools.
Now, you wrote a fantastic book called Read Aside, How Schools Are Killing, How Schools Are Killing Reading and What You Can Do About It. I always forget subtitles. But that was the whole premise is about how schools have changed. What are schools doing specifically that's getting kids to hate reading and writing?
Well, the hard part about writing that book is, you know, for educators is to kind of come at them with this idea that they could be possibly part of the problem. I mean, most teachers I know, almost all teachers I know, care very much. They go in the classroom, they work very hard, and are aware of the factors that are outside of the classroom that cause kids to turn off to reading, you know, print poor environments at home, you know, no access to print locally in libraries and bookstores and things like that. What I think that book does is it opens their eyes a little bit to some of the practices that are occurring in school from well-meaning adults and well-meaning teachers that have actually, I think, also pushed kids closer to turning off to reading.
Well, you're talking about something that I'm very passionate about because I think there's this misconception in the media that this whole accountability movement, as if teachers were just sitting there passing out worksheets and not teaching. What can teachers do to kind of change people's public perception of what teachers actually do in the classroom?
Well, when it comes to reading, I think there are a number of things they could do to move kids towards becoming lifelong readers. I think one of the big problems is that teachers are often forced by the environment that we live in because there are so many standards. Mm-hmm. And I'm not anti-standards. I believe very strongly that teachers should know what the district or the state believes is good teaching. But the problem is that there's far too many standards. And when there are too many standards, when I go back into my classroom tomorrow, you know, it sort of pushes me into a sprint and cover approach. There was a study done recently that found K through 12, there are more than 3,500 benchmark assessments that teachers are being asked to teach. And if we really do go into our classrooms and teach those standards at that level, this study found that we'd have to change K-12 to K-22. And so as a result, you know, we have to go and go and go and go. And my concern is that approach is leading us to raising memorizers rather than thinkers. And so the best teaching that I've seen, and I've been in a number of schools, come from those teachers who kind of step away from that and realize that the kids have to go a little bit deeper, a little bit slower. And that's where kids develop the deeper thinking skills. When it's a sprint and cover approach, again, kids learn a lot, they memorize a lot, but I'm not so sure they're well equipped to go out in the world and really analyze and synthesize and evaluate things.
Well, and critical thinking has always been a theme in the writing of, that you've done. And one of the things that I loved that you were talking about earlier with me, I'd love you to share with everybody, is your book on deeper reading, on comprehension. You had a great baseball analogy. Could you share that with the audience?
Well, I say in that book that learning to read deeply is like learning to be an in-depth baseball fan. When my daughters were very, very young, they would sit next to me at the baseball game, and they'd have sort of a very elementary understanding of the game. They would know, you know, that this guy on the hill is going to throw the ball, that guy with the bat is going to try to hit it, and if he hits it, he's going to run and try to go all the way around the bases, and that team's going to try this 9 times, and our team's going to try that 9 times, and at the end of the day, if our guys score more runs, we go home happy. They understood that when they were very, very small. They also understood where the cotton candy vendor was at all times, but that's another point. What I want to suggest, and what I suggest in deeper reading, is this idea that, yes, although my daughters were sitting next to me and they understood the game, they didn't really understand the game. They didn't see the center fielder cheating a couple steps to the left because the catcher was setting up on the outside corner. They didn't see the third base coach flashing signs or the catcher looking for signs. There's a game within a game in baseball. And I want my kids to see that because I want them to move beyond surface level reading. In fact, in some ways, I think it's more important that they not only just tell us what a text says, but what a text doesn't say. Humpty Dumpty. Humpty Dumpty's about an egg, right? And you can tell me he sat on a wall, and you can tell me he fell off the wall, and they tried to put him back together again, and they were unsuccessful. And that's sort of a surface level reading of that text. But I think if you go back and reread Humpty Dumpty, you'll see that it's really not about an egg. It's about a leader who has fallen, and that once you lose the will of your people as a leader, it might be over. And what I talk about in deeper reading is that if you teach a kid to read Humpty Dumpty that way, or To Kill a Mockingbird that way, then you teach the kid to read the advertisement that way, or the politician that way, or the ballot proposition that way. And to teach kids to think about what a text says and what a text doesn't say takes time. And I'm afraid that that's getting squeezed out in the sprint to cover the next standard and the next standard and the next standard.
It seems like we've become infatuated with depth, not breadth. What I keep on telling people is it's like, oh, I'm so sorry you missed Tuesday, Kelly. It's when we learned how to add, and we're just trying to cover so much. And there's really just no, another point I like to give to politicians is, most politicians, it takes them a couple of years to learn their job. Same thing with teachers. How have you changed as a teacher from 26 years later to when you first started out?
Well, I wrote a book called Read Aside about the killing of reading because I realized that I myself, some of my own practices were kind of leading kids to dislike reading. I think it became kind of fashionable in trying to teach a number of different standards that when, for example, you're teaching a work like Hamlet, right? And a work, when you teach Hamlet and you're trying to cover 17 standards, that work gets chopped up, it gets sliced and diced and becomes an 8-week endurance test for kids to recognize the theme and recognize the foreshadowing and do this and do that with it. And when we slice and dice so much, the beauty of the art, the beauty of the work gets lost. And that beautiful piece of art becomes an extended worksheet. And so I think I've worked very hard in my own classroom. In one way I've become a better teacher is not having the kids do so much on every single page and put a post-it note here and put a post-it note there, but identifying really what the value is in reading this work and kind of designing lessons that will lead kids to that value that doesn't take 10 weeks to read something that's supposed to be meant and to be seen and to be heard in a couple of hours.
Now parents are always asking me, how do they get their kids to read? Now how do you get a high school student interested in Hamlet?
Well, this may not be what every teacher wants to hear, but I don't focus on whether kids like the book or work or not. What I'm really interested is in this idea of the value of reading the text. I like the philosopher Kenneth Burke. He says the reason we have kids read good books, heavy books, is because they provide, and this is his term, not mine, but that they provide imaginative rehearsals for the real world. I've taught a book like 1984 for 20-something years. Mm-hmm. I love the book. Mm-hmm. But you know what? Some of my kids don't like it. It's science fiction. It's dystopian, futuristic. It's dark. It's very, very dark. And some of my kids don't like that genre. But when I teach that to my kids, one of the things I say at the very beginning of that unit is, look, I'm honest with them. I say, some of you are going to like this book. Some of you aren't going to like this book. But if you go through this book the way I have it planned, I promise you that all of you will leave that reading experience with some value. Mm. I stand in front of you today as an adult, I tell them, many, many years after reading this book. And because I've read this book, 1984, that you are about to read, or book X, what it might be. But because I've read this book, 1984, as an adult, even today, I see my government differently. Mm. I don't care who's in office, left or right. I see privacy issues differently. I see language manipulation. I understand euphemisms. And if you go through this reading experience with me, that is the kind of imaginative rehearsals that you will take from that experience into adulthood. That's very different than did you like the book? Mm-hmm. So I think classics have been around for a long time for reasons that there's some value in them. I actually argue in Read Aside there's no such thing as a bad classic. There were classics we all hated to read. When I was in high school, I think I'd rather be out on a Texas highway in summer picking up trash in August than reading The Good Earth.
Yeah.
But I reread it, and guess what? I reread it as an adult. There's some good stuff in there. That's a good book. And I don't think that teacher prepared me to see the value of that book. And I think there's a big difference between assigning literature and teaching it.
What do you think makes a classic?
Well, I think it has imaginative rehearsals in it. Mm-hmm. I think universal truths. You know, I still teach Romeo and Juliet to my ninth graders in Anaheim. You know, the play's 400 years old, but there are questions in there that still resonate with a teenager today. Questions in Anaheim like, can long-term feuds in this neighborhood ever be buried? Do you guide your own life, or is there a greater source? You know, if you want to come down to the ninth grade level, should your parents have say in who you date? I mean, Shakespeare asked these questions 400 years ago, and if I can bring that piece of literature into my classroom and use it as a springboard for my kids to wrestle with these imaginative rehearsals, it gives them that practice so that when they become adults in the real world, they have a little bit more wisdom that's been passed through generations via literature.
You know, I keep on hearing that, oh, kids aren't reading anything, and you've been around now for a while. What are you doing to, especially with now a lot more electronic media out there, what are you doing to incorporate those things to draw kids in towards, so that they can actually get the value of reading, to get them to read more?
Well, one of my concerns is that it's not the actual reading of the words that are on the page that are the problem for my kids. A lot of times my kids can read things that are on a page, but because they're coming to the page with much narrower prior knowledge and background, it's not a decoding issue, or it's not a fluency issue. They can pronounce the words, but if you don't know who the Vice President of the United States is as a ninth grader, it's very difficult to read, you know, something on the front page of the Los Angeles Times. So I believe very strongly that if we have any chance in developing really strong, deeper readers coming out of our K-12 system, that across the curriculum, we have to work very hard in building the lack of prior knowledge and background that they have. Danny, if you handed me a book on baseball, you don't have to frame that for me. You don't have to set it up for me. I can read it. Because in my background, I have a tremendous background on baseball. I've been watching games since I was a kid. But if you hand me a book on the origins of the Big Bang Theory or an electrical engineering guide, I'm in trouble because I don't have the prior knowledge and background to make sense of that text. So what I am finding recently, for example, 9/11 came and went. And it's amazing to me how many of my seniors know very little about that event. They don't understand the prelude. They don't understand the actual day. They don't understand the aftermath. And you know, how can you go off into adulthood when you look at the effect that event has had on our politics, on our economy, on the military, the geopolitical sphere? And the problem is that many of our kids haven't been reading outside of the prescribed textbooks. Mm-hmm. So, and I think the other part is the problem we touched earlier is that we're sprinting and sprinting and sprinting. We don't have time. If 9/11 is being taught, it's being taught 1 hour. Okay, now it's time to move on.
Yeah.
You cannot understand an event like that in 1 hour. So I think all teachers would be better serving our kids if we could surround our standard curriculum with all kinds of reading around that textbook, getting kids into magazines, getting kids into blogs, getting kids online, getting kids to read recreationally, that it's not just a very narrow textbook kind of reading, but we want kids to start doing the kind of reading that's going to build that prior knowledge and background so that when they get to text, they have a chance in comprehending it.
Well, and I love that you're really talking about getting the kids to look at different materials. I think this is how you build critical thinkers. Now, you know, we've been talking about reading, but you're really a great writing instructor. I've watched you talk about writing. It's wonderful. And one of the things, your book, Write Like This, that I love is you really are based on the premise that in order to become good writers, kids need to be reading. Because I've always told kids, I've met lots of good readers who weren't necessarily good writers, but I've never met a good writer who wasn't a good reader. So tell us a little bit about your whole premise of teaching kids how to become those great writers.
Well, I agree wholeheartedly. I mean, as a reader, I think prior knowledge is even more important as a writer. I mean, I might not know about the International Monetary Fund, but I can read about it. But if I don't know about the International Monetary Fund, I can't write about it. So I think the prior knowledge and background is even more essential in building that. I also think there's a lot of assigning of writing going on, and I don't think that's really the best way to teach writing. When I first started, I was a high school basketball coach. And when you teach a kid, you know, when you shoot a basketball, you want backspin on the ball because it gets a softer bounce. You might actually miss a shot, but if it has backspin, you might get a kind bounce and it might actually end up going in. Well, if I want a kid to shoot backspin, if I see a kid who has a knuckleball shot, I'm not going to just yell at him, hey, put backspin on mm-hmm. that ball. I'm going to say, come over here, stand next to me. Watch how I hold this ball. Watch how it comes off my fingertips. Now watch, I'm going to do it two or three or four times. Now you try it. And I think that's how we learned. You know, that's how we learn. We stand next to somebody who knows how to do it. We watch them carefully. And then we emulate them. So that's what I do. I ride alongside my students. I go, then they go. Or I have them stand next to Anna Quinlan or George Will or Rick Riley or somebody who knows how to do it. If I want my kids to write a movie review, I have them stand next to Roger Ebert, watch how he does it, and now you go. So I think it's that emulation, that close examination, and then you go and try it. I mean, I think that's how you learn anything.
Mm-hmm.
I was an executive table technician in college. Some people call that a waiter. And how did I learn, right? I followed somebody who knew how to do it. I shadowed them. And I don't care if you're becoming a waiter or a auto mechanic or a writer. I think our students need a lot more modeling. Mm-hmm. They need a lot more mentor techs, and they need to stand next to somebody who knows how to do it and emulate them.
How many students do you have in a typical class?
Oh, well, these aren't the best of times. This year, I have my class average is about 37.
Yeah, so you have 37 students, Kelly. How difficult is it for you to actually have that time modeling, you modeling, for each of those students in your classroom?
Well, you have to cut corners, mm-hmm. and anybody who thinks that the best writing instruction is going to occur in a class of 37 is wrong. That's a budget issue, of course, in California and nationally. So a lot of the modeling I do is not one-on-one, mm-hmm. it's whole class, where kids, I think, really get the short end of being in a class of 37 is more on the assessment side, because my class of 37 is only one of five classes that I teach.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if we're serious in California about raising reading and writing scores, but since we're talking about writing, I mean, I would also add, you know, California's dirty little secret is that they don't really value writing all that much. You can get a zero on the writing section of the California High School Exit Exam and still pass the test. And not a lot of people know that. So until the state makes the statement that writing is important, that it is a skill that you have to really, get better at before we'll hand you a diploma, it gets pushed to the back burner a lot. Assigning writing is really easy. Teaching writing is really hard, and it takes time. Time when we have 3,500 standards K-12. And so my concern, and I address this in Write Like This, is that writing, which I think is foundational to living a literate life, is actually getting put on the back burner. Yeah. In some places, I've been to a lot of schools around the country, in some places, if I may extend the metaphor, it's being taken off the stove completely.
Yeah, and people are more concerned about filling in bubbles than expressing themselves creatively. And I thought it was interesting when you were talking about the coaching metaphor, you know, because to me that's how you become a much better writer, is having a person take you aside and say, okay, now let's have a conference and discuss what went wrong here. But a coach, if basketball coach has 12 to 15 players, you have 37 players multiplied by five different periods. What can you do? I'm thinking from a teacher point of view now. A teacher's trying to manage a class. What are some ways that we can actually help foster writing in our classrooms without us being the model specifically for our students?
Well, the first thing is I would say stop grading everything. I don't really think grading makes my students better writers. Mm-hmm. It sorts them. It sorts the winners from losers. Who are the A's? Who are the B's? Who are the C's? But the only two things that really make my kids better writing is modeling and conferencing. And showing them how to do it and giving them some sort of feedback that will help them move their papers to a better place. Mm-hmm. If the problem with that that high of class sizes, the problem with having those many kids in a day, is that if I collect 170 essays and I'm going to go home and write on every one of them, it's going to take me a while. And if I say to my kids, don't do any more writing until I get these commented on, I mean, in the real world, it's going to take me 2 or 3 weeks to get those papers back. They're going to sit there for 3 weeks and not do any writing. If we follow that paradigm, what will happen is we'll get to the end of the year and they will not have as much practice, because what we are finding out is that practice is also a big, big part of it. You know, there's the 10,000-hour rule that's been mentioned a lot lately. Malcolm Gladwell talks about that a lot in his book, Outliers, that nobody gets really good in anything, mm-hmm. whether you're a computer tech or a video game player or a musician. The greatness comes at about 10,000 hours. And so looking at my kids in my classroom, I recognize they need a ton more practice. But teachers aren't giving them the practice mm-hmm. because they don't want the paper load coming back at them. So we have to devise systems in which kids write 2 or 3 papers and we give them credit for them, but then they determine which one they would like graded, or I determine which one they like graded. So I like to set it up where my kids are getting lots of practice, but you write 3, I grade 1. You write 4, I grade 1.
Is there something, I mean, you're a parent, you have 2 daughters, congratulations.
Thank you.
Your beautiful wife, Kristen, is here today. Now, as a parent, I know it's different once you're a parent teaching. What do you think a parent could do to help their child become a better writer?
Well, first thing is to surround your kids with language. Reading and writing is all about how many words you know, how much language you've been exposed to. One study I read recently indicated that your level of literacy entering kindergarten is a strong indicator of where you will exit the 12th grade. Mm-hmm. So surrounding kids, talking to your kids, giving your kids books. I'm reminded of Jim Trelease, who talks about the 3 B's. Your kid should have books at the breakfast table, your kid should have books in the bathroom, and your kid should have books at the bedside. And making sure that your kids read at least 20 minutes a day recreationally or for fun. Many of the students that I'm coming across these days suffer from what I call in Readicide is word poverty. Mm-hmm. And when you suffer from word poverty, it's very hard to put concepts together. And it's very hard to go deeper and richer in your thinking if you are impoverished in the language that's confronting you. So you want your kid to be the best reader possible. You want your kid to be the best writer possible. You have to read and write and talk with them. I think my daughters, from the time they were born until they told me they wouldn't sit with me anymore, you know, late into high school, I could probably count on one hand how many nights I did not sit and read with them. Kids who are language advantaged become the best readers and writers.
Yeah, it becomes the Matthew effect. And it's interesting because you teach at a high school where you have a large population of students that English isn't their first language. What are some tips that you give to those students and to their parents on ways that they can really develop that language, especially English language skills?
Well, students who are behind or students who are developing a language, there's only one way they're going to catch up, and that's a word flood, book flood, writing flood. Mm-hmm. My concern in a lot of schools that I've seen, that kids who are behind or kids who are developing into English language speakers are often put in tracks or put into programs where they're slowed down, where they're given worksheets, where the reading and writing expectations are lowered. You know, these kids are not very advanced, so we must slow things down. And I actually think that's the exact wrong approach. I think those kids should be accelerated. The kids who are behind, the kids who are acquiring language, they need twice as much reading. They need twice as much writing as everybody else on that campus.
Well, and you'd mentioned, because I use outliers all the time. I think Malcolm Gladwell's right on the nose where he uses Bill Gates specifically as an example with computer skills. I don't know if in the book it was mentioned, but I remember listening to Will Smith saying it took him 10,000 hours of acting to become an actor. What could we do as educators and parents that are concerned to help get these kids that 10,000 hours? And I understand we're in a time of budget cutbacks. What are some basic things that we can that you propose that we could possibly do?
Well, on the parent side, I'm not anti-technology. Mm-hmm. I'm not anti-Twitter. I'm on Twitter myself. I'm not anti...
And let's make sure we get... I forgot to plug.
But
we have to plug it. Let's make sure we get Kelly's Twitter site. And his website is kellygallagher.org. Now, it's very important that they put .org because .com, it turns out you share a name with an adult movie star from the 1980s.
Yes, if you go to kellygallagher.com rather than .org, you're going to have an entirely different experience. So just know that ahead of time. But if you want to look at some ideas about reading and writing, kellygallagher.org is the place you want to go.
And you're a big Twitter person. And so we just have a little bit of time, so let's wrap up. Let's talk about, just at the end there, about how we can incorporate technology to boost reading and writing skills.
Yeah, I think technology can be an ally, not a foe. However, I am concerned that kids are coming to me now from homes where the only reading they're doing is internet reading, which is valuable. But it exercises the brain in a little bit different way. There's a lot more of a click and go, more of a surface level exercise to your brain that when you're surfing online versus having an actual book in your hand that requires you to cognitively work your way through those 300 pages. And what I would like is for parents to balance that, to make sure that kids are reading magazines, make sure kids are reading books, and of course, as parents, modeling that yourself.
Great. I'm sorry to cut you off, Kelly.
Okay.
We're running down. It's just been such a pleasure to have Kelly again. You can go to Kelly's website. It's kellygallagher.org. Folks, there are amazing people in this community all around us. People like Kelly are around us every single day. Remember, you can make a difference too. People make a difference every single day. We'll see you next time. Thank you and God bless.